We are live.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Pamana Bhende, ma'am, and talking on basic interpretation of clinical genes of optic neuropathy and angiography. I request Dr. Nitishwar to please introduce, ma'am.
Very good evening to all of you. It is my privilege and an honor to introduce Dr. Mona Bhinde, ma'am. She needs no introduction. Ma'am is a teacher par excellence at Shankar Netralaya Chennai. And though I have not been a direct student of her, I have been honored enough to learn from her at so many platforms and it's really a pleasure. And we are so privileged that today ma'am is here with us to teach us. Ma'am is currently the senior consultant and deputy director at Shankar Netralaya Chennai and a teacher for all of us. So over to Dr. Mona Bhinde, ma'am, to please take us through OCT angiography. It'll be a great learning for all of you students and for all of us also today here who are here to listen to her. Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening. Shall I share my screen?
Yeah. Yes.
I think you have to stop sharing.
Rolika's screen is still on.
Yeah, I can't share. Rolika, you'll have to leave. Stop sharing.
Sunil ji, can you do something?
Yeah.
It's stopped, ma'am. It's stopped.
Yeah.
Oh. 1 second. So you can see my screen, right?
Yes, ma'am, we can.
So good evening, everyone. My talk today will be a little overview of the principles and applications of optical coherence tomography angiography, which we commonly call OCTA. Probably in ophthalmology now, OCT is the most widely used imaging modality, because it provides micron scale depth resolution and is uniquely able to resolve internal structures non-invasively. It's used for diagnosis, it's used for follow-up, assessment of treatment efficacy, and we also have OCT-based biomarkers. However, its limitation is its inability to accurately image the capillaries, as it is based on tissue reflectance alone. Whereas OCTA is an extension of OCT that uses motion contrast to visualize blood vessels down to the capillary level. So it takes care of most of the limitations of OCT. In simple terms, it's based on the ability to image flow in the retinal and choroidal vasculature. The major benefit is the need for a dye, thereby reducing injection-related complications that we're all worried about. We all know, because I know you've had classes on fluorescein angiogram and ICG in the previous talks, and we know that it's very important to catch the transit window, which is very narrow, because the dye flows out, the dye leaks and obscures the details. Whereas OCT angiogram eliminates this transit window seen both with fluorescein angiogram and ICG angiography. If you look at this FFA and ICG of a patient here, you see there is this ill-defined area of hyperfluorescence on the ICG angiogram, nothing much seen on the fluorescein. But if you do an OCT angiogram, you see that this leakage is actually coming from a network of blood vessels. So this is the benefit of OCT angiography. And there is very limited obscuration of retinal and vascular features that may occur with dye leakage. Of course, there is some obscuration, but we can use that to interpret the image. So basically, the principle is to use the variation in OCT signals caused by moving particles such as red blood cells as the contrast mechanism for imaging blood flow. If you look at this picture, you see there is a nice network of vessels that you're seeing, and it's very hard to believe that there is no dye that is flowing through the vessels. And how do we achieve this? Basically, in OCT, a light beam is split into an exploring arm and a reference arm to generate the image. The light from the exploring arm undergoes various kinds of modification. It has reflection, it has refraction, it has attenuation. When it comes out different from the light which went into the eye. Now we compare the two pictures, the reference arm as well as the exploring arm, and this difference is what generates the image. And multiple such scans are compiled. So basically what we get is an A scan, and multiple such scans are compiled to form a B scan, and the B scan can be compiled further to form a three-dimensional image that can be used to interpret depth as well as structural result anatomy. OCT uses the same principle. However, here we have two successive A scans which go through the same spot. And these two scans are separated by a specific time period, which is reasonable so that it allows the patient to fixate at the same spot for two successive scans. And the difference between these two scans, which is caused by movement of the red blood cells, is what is called the decorrelation signal. And this decorrelation signal forms the basis of the image. And this mirrors the vasculature. Okay. So this in simple terms is what happens when you have two OCT beams. Here you have one OCT beam that is going through the artery and bypassing the vein, and you have one more OCT beam that is again going through the artery, but here you see it hits a red blood cell. Here it passes between the red blood cells, and the detected A scan signals are different, and this difference is processed, and this processing results in an OCT A signal which is caused by blood flow. Now, how do we interpret this in the eye? This is a schematic description of the retinal circulation, where we now know we have three vascular plexuses, which are present in different layers of the retina: the superficial vascular complex, the intermediate complex, and the deep capillary plexus. And these are present either between the superficial vascular complex is located in the nerve fiber layer and the ganglion cell IPL layer. The deep vascular complex is between the inner nuclear and the outer plexiform layer. And the intermediate complex, which is visualized in certain systems like the Heidelberg, straddles between the ganglion cell IPL layer and the inner nuclear layer. And at different levels, when you see the flow signals, you are able to identify the structures. And this is a comparison of a histological slide as well as an OCT angiogram of a normal eye. And you see how well the OCT angiogram mirrors the histology. So basically, we know that OCTA is based on the ability to image flow in the retinal and choroidal vasculature. And one can see it either as abnormal presence of flow, normal flow, absence of flow, and abnormality in the visual geometry. And if you're looking at retinal vascular disorders, you would need to look in the superficial and deep slabs, which image the superficial and deep capillary plexus. The outer retinal slab is avascular. If you look at the slide, you see that the outer retinal slab is avascular. So any vascularity you pick up in these areas is either an artifact or pathological. And the structures that cause pathological vascular signals in the outer retinal slabs are choroidal neovascular membranes. However, as we shall see later, we also need to be aware of artifacts, especially projection or segmentation artifacts, because the whole image on OCTA depends on accurate segmentation. And I'll show you some artifacts as we go along. And we still need to compare it with the structural OCT, because OCT angiogram is not really able to diagnose active leakage. So we can get three patterns of abnormality on OCT angiogram. You can get the abnormal presence of flow, and this is due to your vascularization, either retinal or choroidal. Here is an example of a choroidal neovascular membrane, where you see a network in the normally avascular outer retinal choriocapillaries slab. And this is the B scan showing the flow signal, indicating that this is indeed a vascular complex. And if you look carefully, the B scan also shows us that there is fluid, indicating that the lesion is active. A clue to the presence of fluid on the OCT angiogram is the presence of this dark halo that can disappear once the lesion is treated well. You can also get abnormal vessel geometry, such as dilated vessels or aneurysms. If you look at this slide, you see that the vessels are dilated and tortuous, and the commonest condition that can occur causing dilated and tortuous vessels, we all know, is central retinal vein occlusion. And one can always compare it with the other eye to make sure that the vessels are indeed pathological. You can also get absence of flow, such as non-perfusion or capillary dropout. Here you see an area of non-perfusion within which you find an area of abnormal flow. So this is a patient with a peripheral vascular occlusion, a peripheral retinal vein occlusion with neovascularization, which typically occurs at the junction of the perfused and the non-perfused areas. So we know now that there are three patterns of abnormality. It could be abnormal presence of flow, abnormal vessel geometry, or absence of flow. Now coming to where do we look for abnormalities? Because as I mentioned to you, interpreting OCT angiogram is all about imaging the correct slab and doing a proper segmentation. So as far as retinal vascular disorders are concerned, OCT angiogram is an excellent tool for imaging areas of ischemia and non-perfusion, as I showed you in the last slide. It can detect neovascularization, both retinal and choroidal. But the major importance of OCT angiogram is its ability to image the deep retinal capillary plexus and the radial peripapillary capillaries. This is something that is not possible with fundus fluorescein angiogram. However, it's limited by the field of view, though we have certain advanced machines, as I'll show you later, where you get very wide field images. Many commercial machines have a very small field of view. And on its own, though there are certain clues, it does not indicate if the neovascularization is leaking. So if you're looking at vessels in the superficial capillary plexus, you would be looking in the retinal nerve fiber layer or the ganglion cell layer. Whereas the intermediate retinal capillary plexus and the deep retinal capillary plexus are located in the inner and outer edges of the inner nuclear layer respectively. And all of you are very familiar with retinal blood supply, so I think this should not be anything confusing. The intermediate retinal capillary plexus is picked in only a few machines like the Heidelberg. Not all the machines pick up the intermediate retinal capillary plexus. They pick up only the superficial and the deep. Now coming to OCT angiography in diabetic retinopathy, because previously we all felt that it was not the greatest investigation to image a patient with diabetic macular edema. However, we now know that OCT angiography may detect diabetic retinopathy even before it is evident clinically. You can get an increased FAS or a larger foveal avascular zone. You can get decreased parafoveal vascular density. Here you have a dropout of the capillaries in the parafoveal area. And you may have a lower foveal density of the deep capillary plexus. And these patients are at a higher risk of developing diabetic retinopathy. There are various quantitative metrics which have been studied, and these correlate with the severity of diabetic retinopathy: enlarged FAS area, decreased FAS circularity, lower vascular density, increased BDI, decreased foveal flow density, and increased vessel tortuosity are significantly associated with worsening diabetic retinopathy. There are certain signs which are associated with progression of diabetic retinopathy, and these are the FAS, the vascular density, and the foveal density. And these show significant associations with the risk of diabetic retinopathy progression. However, most of these findings are currently not very applicable clinically, though it forms the basis of many research papers. Now, this is a patient where we have used the conventional way of imaging. You see that there are two cercinates temporal to the macula. You see there are a few microaneurysms and hemorrhages within the cercinates. And you see on OCT that there is a temporal thickening of the macula. This is a patient with a focal macular edema, and your fluorescein angiogram shows up the microaneurysms leaking very well. Another patient with proliferative diabetic retinopathy as well as macular edema. And patients with proliferative diabetic retinopathy, the OCTA is very easily able to pick up neovascularization with the corresponding B scan showing the macular thickening. And I'll show you some examples now. There was this interesting paper which showed us that neovascularization in proliferative diabetic retinopathy can be of three types in addition to intraretinal microvascular abnormalities. Though this may appear very theoretical, I think most of us who operate cases of diabetic retinopathy will very well relate to our understanding of the type of neovascularization. For example, you have a type 1 neovascularization where you have a single stalk with a branching vessel coming out of the vein. This is probably the simplest one. Here you see that the vessel is coming out and going along the posterior hyoid. It's growing up here on the OCT and the flow signal. And here you see it is on the bifurcation of the vessel on the OCT angiogram. So this is type 1 neovascularization. That's probably the easiest to handle. Whereas type 2 neovascularization, here you see there is a stalk in the inner nuclear layer and it grows in multiple directions. The central stalk shows a radiation in multiple directions, as in this picture of a patient. This is the fluorescein angiogram. Here again, you see the stalk coming out from the retina and you see that there is a flow signal on either side. So this is something that we may be a little cautious about operating. Whereas type 3 neovascularization is what most of us would read, where we have broad attachments to the vein and you have new vessels coming as a broad in a broad format and growing on the retinal surface. This is type 3 neovascularization. Here you see the new vessels are growing on both sides of the vein. And the last type is intraretinal microvascular abnormalities or IRMA, which is characterized by proliferation within the retina. However, sometimes at certain points, you may see that the proliferation breaks through. And here you see a patient with intraretinal microvascular abnormalities giving rise to neovascularization on the retinal surface. And you see this OCT angiogram showing that there's an IRMA and new vessel it also tells you IRMA never crosses the vessel. So when you see something crossing the vessel, you know it is neovascularization. Now, as I mentioned, there are certain OCT angiograms which give us this beautiful wide field view, and I'm privileged to be able to use one of them. And this is a patient of proliferative diabetic retinopathy. You almost think this is a fluorescein angiogram because it shows you the neovascularization of the disc, it shows you a large front of neovascularization around the arcade, and it shows you these patchy areas of non-perfusion. And similarly in the left eye. The advantage is these neovascularizations are not obscured by any leakage, which is what we would see on a fluorescein angiogram. And this is the B scan of the same patient. You see here the neovascularization arising from the disc and growing across the posterior hyoid, associated with macular edema and a neurosensory retinal detachment. And this is the picture of the left eye. If you look very carefully, you will see that OCT angiogram is also able to pick up these little areas of microaneurysms. Now, sometimes you see, this is a patient, I took a picture basically out of curiosity. This patient had a small area of neovascularization just above the arcade, nothing else, small areas of non-perfusion. The patient also had center involving macular edema. And we did the wide field montage image, keeping the disc in the center. And this confirmed the presence of neovascularization elsewhere. However, as this was not high risk neovascularization, we decided to observe the patient and treat the center involving DME with anti-VEGF. And if you look carefully, 1 month later, you see this neovascularization has shrunk, indicating that anti-VEGF agents also work on proliferative tissue. And if you look at the B scan of this patient, it shows that the foveal cyst has reduced after one injection of ranibizumab. And here is the neovascularization. You see how it has shrunk a little bit. But we have to be wary of these neovascularizations that respond, because if you're complacent and stop treating the patient because there's no edema, this neovascularization is going to rebound again. This is another patient. This is pre and post panretinal photocoagulation of a patient with proliferative diabetic retinopathy. Notice that you cannot see any photocoagulation marks in this eye. Neither does non-perfusion area disappear. However, what we do see post-PRP is the neovascularization of the disc has shrunk, as well as this area of neovascularization elsewhere. The vessels have become thinner. What we call the medusa appearance has now become like a dead tree, where the branching is less and the vessels are thinner. This is just 1 month after panretinal photocoagulation, and we expect these changes to improve with time. It was always felt that microaneurysms were too small to be detected on OCT angiogram, but now we know with a careful segmentation, because certain microaneurysms are present in the superficial plexus, certain microaneurysms in the deep plexus. And the microaneurysms in the deep plexus may not leak much on fluorescein angiogram because it doesn't pick it up very well. And the OCT angiogram, if you look very carefully, you can find that there are various configurations of microaneurysms in diabetic retinopathy. You can have a focal bulge. You can have a saccular microaneurysm. You can have fusiform microaneurysms. You can have a mix of saccular and fusiform. You can have pedunculated as well as irregular microaneurysms if you do a proper segmentation at different levels. And we also know now that there are certain microaneurysms that may be missed on OCT angiogram because the flow, as I mentioned, the flow has to be optimal for the lesion to be picked up. If a lesion has a very fast flow, then the time between the two scans may not be sufficient to image the flow through that vessel. Similarly, if the lesion has a very low flow, then the scan, the inter-scan time, that is the time between two successive times, may not be able to pick up the difference because the red blood cells either move very slowly or they do not move at all. So it's all about picking up the optimal interscan time to pick up a specific lesion. However, this is not possible in all commercial machines. So most of them have come to a happy medium where the patient is also comfortable, able to fixate at the same spot for a reasonable length of time, and you are able to pick up most images with a reasonable degree of accuracy. This is an OCT of a patient with macular edema. Here you see there was edema approaching the center. This is the patient without treatment. Here you see the edema is increased. And if you look carefully, if you focus deeper, you see that there is a single microaneurysm that you're able to pick in the deep complex. Again, these are images from the Heidelberg, which we have in our Kolkata branch. I don't have much experience with this, which picks up the superficial, the intermediate, and the deep plexus. And you're able to pick up microaneurysms in different levels. OCT angiogram also helps us sometimes to pick up unexpected findings, such as this patient who was on treatment for diabetic macular edema suddenly came with a large bleed, and you see the OCT here shows there's an irregular pigment epithelial detachment with cystoid macular edema over it. And this should raise the red flag. If you look at the OCT angiogram, it shows that there was a sub-RP network of vessels indicating that this patient had a combination of neovascular AMD and macular edema due to diabetes. So OCT angiogram does help to pick this up because sometimes fluorescein angiogram may miss it and patients who are very sick may not be fit for fluorescein angiogram. This is a picture of different plexus of a normal eye showing the superficial capillary plexus, the deep capillary plexus, and the choriocapillary layers. And this is the reflectivity of the ellipsoid zone. This is a healthy eye, and this is what a normal picture looks like. However, if you look at a patient with diabetic retinopathy, you see immediately the difference. There is reduced perfusion in the deep capillary plexus, and you also see, compared to this picture, you see in this is the ellipsoid zone reflectivity, and you see these dark patches indicating a reduction in ellipsoid zone reflectivity. And this indicates, we know that the ellipsoid zone represents photoreceptors. So reduction of perfusion in the deep capillary plexus along with reduction in ellipsoid zone reflectivity acts as a surrogate for photoreceptor damage. And as I mentioned, we often need a B scan to compare, because if you look at the OCT A of this patient before and after aflibercept for central retinal vein occlusion, you see there are very subtle changes. If you look carefully, you'll say, yes, the vessels look less tortuous, they look less dilated. But the more dramatic picture is the B scan, which shows there's a significant reduction in macular edema. And that is why most of the time we require an B scan along with an OCT angiogram if we are looking at assessing treatment response. And how does it compare with fluorescein angiogram and a B scan? This is a patient with an infrotemporal branch retinal vein occlusion. Here you see hemorrhages along the infrotemporal branch vein. The fluorescein angiogram shows areas of capillary dropout, the staining of the vessels because of ischemia, and cystoid macular edema. Similarly, this is another patient with an infrotemporal branch vein occlusion. Here you see there is no obscuration of the vessels. There is no leakage due to ischemia. You see the vessels here. You see a few collaterals and a large area of capillary dropout. And you also note that the central fovea is thinned out. There is some edema in the parafoveal area. Again, sometimes you can take a look at the structural scan. Here, you see the dilated tortuous vessels. You see the B scan on the corresponding OCT image. But if you look at the structural scan, you can see that this patient also has cystoid macular edema. So you can play around with your images to get as close a picture as what is mirroring reality. This is a patient, again, a wide field OCT angiography image of a patient with an infrotemporal vein occlusion. Here you very well see the block here. This is the area of the occlusion, the large areas of capillary dropout. This is the superficial capillary plexus, something that we are very easily able to interpret because it looks like a fluorescein angiogram. It looks like a fundus photo, except that it's black and white. But what the OCT angiogram tells us is that in a vascular occlusion, the involvement of the deeper capillary plexus is far larger than the superficial capillary plexus. In fact, sometimes what appears to be a perfused vein occlusion, you may have areas of non-perfusion in the deep capillary plexus. So when you're imaging a patient with a vascular occlusion, it's important to look at both the superficial and the deep capillary slabs. As I mentioned here, this is the deep capillary slab showing the area of non-perfusion, and this is the superficial slab. The superficial slab showing that the area of non-perfusion looks much less. So as I mentioned, it's important to look at both. And you can also look at it to follow up the patient. On the surface, it looks as if everything is okay. There is no macular edema the first visit. There's no macular edema the second visit. The patient is doing fine. Nothing wrong in that. But what does the OCT angiography tell you? The OCT angiography tells you that this was the fresh vascular occlusion. And a couple of months later, you see that the collateral channels have now developed, indicating that this patient has developed a compensatory vascular occlusion. So these are some of the interesting findings you would be able to pick up on the OCT angiography if you look carefully in it. So how do these investigations compare, especially in retinal vein occlusion and diabetic retinopathy? OCT angiogram gives us a good correlation with the clinical, anatomical, and fluorescein angiogram findings of capillary dropout, retinal atrophy, increased vessel caliber, shunt vessels, and the presence of intraretinal edema and neovascularization, as we've seen in the slides earlier. Now, what do we see better on OCT angiogram? Irregularities of the FAS that are not obscured by leakage, and changes in the microvasculature, which are located in the deep capillary plexus, which may help us to understand certain conditions of unexplained visual loss. However, the B-scan OCT is still better to quantify macular edema and assess the response to treatment. And we do recommend that people look at the B-scan when they're following up a patient on treatment rather than OCT angiogram alone. Though in certain cases of neovascular pathology, OCT angiogram may be sufficient. But if you want to detect leakage, then most certainly fluorescein angiogram is better, because we do know that sometimes even fibrotic vessels can be picked up on OCT angiogram, and you may get a little confused thinking that it is neovascularization which is active. So where are we now in retinal vascular disorders? We are able to visualize mass vascular, morphological, and distributional characteristics of the vasculature, more specifically in the deep vascular plexus that I showed you. We can understand pathophysiological processes, like you saw the neovascularization in diabetic retinopathy. We can determine whether there is activity. It has a predictive value, and it enables appropriate treatment and follow-up. As I showed you earlier, we are able to classify microaneurysms, neovascularization, and proliferative diabetic retinopathy. And the most investigated quantified indices right now are vascular density and foveal avascular zone. And these correlate to diabetic retinopathy, severity, and visual function, and are useful in predicting response to treatment. Previously, we used to look at the FAS enlargement on fluorescein angiogram. Now you can see the enlargement of the FAS on OCT angiogram. Now coming to the other area where OCT angiography is definitely important, and I think all of us would agree that it's become invaluable in identifying choroidal neovascular membranes, which are located in the outer retina choriocapillaries, and the choriocapillary slab. The most important use of OCT angiogram is detection of a type 1 sub-RP CNVN. We know that sub-RP lesions are not well picked up on fluorescein angiogram. They're better picked up on ICG angiography, but not everyone has an ICG angiogram. So sub-RP lesions are very well picked up on the OCT angiogram. And we know there is an OCT finding called subretinal hyperreflective material or SHREM. And this is indicative of activity. However, SHREM can be avascular or vascular, and probably OCT angiogram is able to differentiate between the two. It is easy to assess treatment response and recurrence, and I'll show you some slides as we go along. And it's also important to detect asymptomatic choroidal neovascular membranes, indicating the need for a quick follow-up. Now, this is a middle-aged lady who was asymptomatic in the right eye. And this is what happens when you are in the habit of imaging both eyes for a patient who's on treatment of the fellow eye. She was on anti-VEGF treatment for post-inflammatory CNVN, and she used to be followed up with an OCT angiogram every few months. At one of the visits, we saw this little yellow spot below the fovea. The patient was totally asymptomatic. The B scan showed a little bit of irregularity here. There was nothing much seen on the OCT angiogram in the ORCC staff, but definitely some abnormality was suspected. The patient came back in a few weeks because we called her back, and you see now the OCT has changed dramatically. You see there's an elevation of the pigment epithelium. You have subretinal hyperreflective material, disruption of the pigment epithelium and subretinal fluid, indicative that there is something active going along. And this was the clinical picture of the lady. The same yellow spot has grown significantly in size, now surrounded by hemorrhage, indicating that there is activity. And this was the OCT angiogram showing that that indistinct area had now become an abnormal neovascular complex surrounded by the halo I spoke to you, indicative of activity. And this was the corresponding B scan. After three injections of anti-VEGF agents, you see this lesion has shrunk, and the OCT angiogram shows us now this small little shrunken lesion. There is no fluid, there is no blood around the lesion, and the lesion has now become more compact. However, you see there is still a little flow signal indicating that it may reactivate at a later date and the patient needs to be on close follow-up. Now, this is an elderly gentleman with an immature cataract, mildly subnormal vision, a poorly dilating pupil. He had a few drusens. He had mid-peripheral reticular pigmentation. He had astroid hyalosis. But his elder brother had geographic atrophy. And he was referred to us for evaluation prior to cataract surgery. And this was his OCTB scan of the right eye showing an irregular pigment epithelium elevation. Similar in the left eye with a small epiretinal membrane. However, this was an inactive lesion because there's no fluid above this. A couple of months later, you see that the retina is thickened, and you see now that this irregular area is now looking fuzzy with an area of subretinal hyperreflectivity. The left eye looks the same. This was the fluorescein angiogram and the ICG. The fluorescein angiogram showed that there was this little neovascular network that was leaking in the late phases. The ICG didn't pick up anything particular. And after ranibizumab in the right eye, you see the lesion has shrunk at the end of 1 month. It has become more compact. The retinal thickening has reduced and the foveal contour is getting normalized. And this was the left eye showing the same irregular elevation of the pigment epithelium. A month later, he came back, and now the B scan shows these cystic spaces, though his vision was still good. And you look at the OCT angiogram at this point in time, you see that there is a neovascular membrane in the outer retina choriocapillaries slab with a little bit of fluid overlying it, indicating that there is activity. And after two injections of ranibizumab, you look at the OCT here, you see that this area has shrunk. This area has remained the same. And if you look carefully, we did mention that we cannot pick up leakage on fluorescein on OCT angiography. But if you look at the appearance of this part of the neovascular network compared to this part, you see that these outlines are a little fuzzy. And this is the part that shrinks with treatment, indicating that this is probably the active network. The patient was observed with serial OCT angiographies, and he has and still maintains fairly good vision. But on observation, a 2 month later OCT angiogram showed that there was a little outpouching from the pre-existing membrane, indicating that there was a recurrence of activity. And you see later, another 2 months later, you see one more frondus now appearing, corresponding to the original vascular network. So there are certain predictors of recurrent exudation, and this is what we see, the presence of branching with tiny vessels. And at the terminal of this choroidal neovascular membrane, you see these branching vessels that grow up. And this was the left eye, which did not show anything at the first visit. This was the OCT angiogram, which showed there was a quiet neovascular membrane with no evidence of any fluid. The patient was on regular follow-ups, and suddenly one fine day we found there was a little bit of macular thickening. Here you see a new area of neovascularization. At this point, the patient was advised treatment, and then the lockdown happened. And he came back a couple of months later, and you see how this membrane has grown significantly. Again, you see this fuzzy area indicating that this is an actively leaking tissue. So we've spoken about type 1 and type 2 membranes. Type 3 membranes or retinal angiomatous proliferation is a challenging condition for most of us to manage. Here we have neovascularization, which begins within the retina and then goes deeper, compared to type 1 and type 2 neovascular membranes, where the vessels grow in the deeper layers and may go superficial. And this is an area where OCT angiogram can help. This is a gentleman with advanced glaucoma who presented with a small subretinal hemorrhage in the left eye and a little blurring of vision. The OCT did not show anything very particular if you look at the B scan, but this is the flow signal showing indication of a flow in this area. And if you look carefully in the outer retina choriocapillary slab, there's this tiny little neovascular membrane. Though the patient was advised treatment, he said, I'm okay, I don't want treatment now, I'll come back later. And he came back later, and you see this membrane has grown in size, and you also see on the B scan there's macular thickening and area of neovascularization has increased. And despite our best efforts, though the activity reduced, you see there's a persistent core of neovascularization that refuses to go away, and it is now connecting into the corona. So this is the B scan OCT angiogram, which shows you the flow of the vessel coming from the retinal surface into the corona. And these are various things you can do with your images. You can make multicolored depictions that look dramatic, easy to explain to the patient. This is a patient with an advanced type 3 neovascular membrane. Here you see the retinal vessels dipping into this point, and the OCTA B scan shows the vascularity dipping down. And this is the deeper choroid layer showing that there is a small network at the base. And if you look at the video, this is the B scan showing the retinochoroidal anastomosis. And you see the video as it goes deeper. You see that the neovascular membrane in the deeper layers are picked. So having a flow chart, a flow picture along with the video gives you quite dramatic results. And this is an MHJ reconstruction of a patient with retinochoroidal anastomosis showing a large neovascular network in the deeper slabs. This is the same patient who underwent anti-VEGF injections. And after 3 anti-VEGF injections, you see that the activity has reduced, but the communication persists, indicating that this eye is prone to recurrences. So we do need to be aware of artifacts, both motion and segmentation, and these are the important artifacts. Projection artifacts, where vascular structures of superficial layers are displayed incorrectly in deeper layers and can be mistaken for neovascularization. It is an optical method of imaging. So if you have dense media haze, you may have signal loss. Segmentation artifacts may also lead to incorrect OCTA results. We are still learning, and careful segmentation is very important. Then we also have vessel doubling and motion artifacts. Motion artifacts are seen in uncooperative patients with poor vision, so you may not get a good picture. And this is an example of a projection artifact where you see the retinal vessel on the surface of the pigment epithelial detachment is incorrectly projected into the avascular space. And if you don't look at the B scan, you may think this is a neovascular membrane. And these are edge artifacts that you can get, and these are motion artifacts where, due to patient movements, you get these horizontal lines. So as I mentioned earlier, it's important to compare with structural OCT scans. We are not there yet, as in this patient, where the OCTA may not show much of a change, but the B scan is fairly dramatic. So I would conclude by saying that OCTA is based on image ability to image flow in the retinal and choroidal vasculature, and these abnormalities can be of different types. We should know where to look for, depending on what you want to find. The superficial and deep slabs for the retinal vascular disorders, avascular outer retinal slabs for choroidal neovascular membranes. We have to be very wary of artifacts and compare with structural OCT to diagnose active leakage. And most importantly, I would like to share this picture of the optometrists who do our OCT and OCT angiogram. And I think without them, most of our diagnostic capabilities would be very much reduced. So on behalf of the Retina Services of Shankar Netralaya, thank you for inviting me to be part of this teaching program.
Thanks a lot, ma'am. That was such an interesting talk and a lot of things to learn for us. I hope all the postgraduates who have gone through this will just go through this talk again and again, because such an important talk on OCT angiography. Radhika, can we first start off with the questions, if you have any questions from the
audience?
Yes,
sir. I'm just gathering the questions, so just give me 2 minutes.
Ma'am, in the meantime, I would like to know the major challenges one can anticipate while reading an OCT angiography. What are the major problems with an OCT angiography that you would like our students to know about?
Yeah, I think sometimes we ask for an OCT angiogram, we're not sure what we're looking for. So the first thing is you should have a working diagnosis, so that you need to know where you're looking. Now, if you're looking at a diabetic retinopathy, you have to look at superficial and deep plexus. And a 3 millimeter scan is not going to give you enough information. So I think sometimes we image too little, sometimes we image too much. But I think the most important is, if you are doing it yourself, you need to know where you're looking, what you're looking for, what you're suspecting. Even a B scan can give you some idea where you need to image. Establish your protocols. Like, say, supposing you're imaging a diabetic retinopathy, have your protocols. These are the kind of images I want. If you're doing it yourself, fine. If you have an optometrist team like I do, I just say diabetic retinopathy protocol. And we've already made that list of what they need to do.
Right.
And they will do it for us. But if I'm looking for a choroidal neovascular membrane in a diabetic, then I need to mention I would also like to see the deeper slabs.
Right. It's very important for, as ma'am said, to really have your protocols. I think this works well for even in general the multimodal imaging that we have now, to have these protocols ready, disease-based, so that we know when our optometrists know exactly what they have to do for our patients.
Because sometimes we expect them to be even better than us.
Yeah.
They say, no, they missed that. They didn't look for it. I say, you should have told them.
Right. And how often now with the advancing machines in OCT angio that we are seeing, has your experience with artifacts have started going down? Now the number of artifactual images, are still there are certain artifacts which you often encounter while tackling OCT angiography?
Yeah, I think sometimes when you're asking for a very dense imaging and the patient has very poor vision, see, the swept source will go very well. It's faster, it's deeper, it will go through an undilated pupil. But the other machines, if the patient has very poor vision, is not able to fixate, then you're going to get a lot of artifacts. So I think that is something we need to decide, which patient is suitable to have a fluorescein angiogram. And if you're looking at treating them with laser, then I think a fluorescein angiogram is good.
Right. Radhika, our question.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. The first question is, what is the clinical significance or implications of identifying the various morphological types of neovascularizations or microaneurysms?
Yeah, that's a good question. So probably Ritesh will agree with me that we can relate to those various patterns of neovascularization. I don't think that study really aimed at giving a clinical application. It was more of an understanding of how an OCT angiogram can show us where exactly the vessels originate. And definitely if we are to see some of them on OCT angiogram, we'll be a little wary of operating those eyes. So I think it's surgical implications as well.
It just gives us a little better tool to plan our surgery when we are going in. What should we be anticipating?
And microaneurysms, I think most of us are still not using it as a tool to treat because as everyone knows, we only treat leaking microaneurysms. But yes, previously it was felt that OCTA doesn't pick them up. Now we know it picks it up and it tells us the shape because it's able to overcome that problem that is caused by leakage. So I think it's more of an understanding of the disease than, and the fact that we are able to pick up all this, that we are slowly beginning to understand.
Just to complete this question, ma'am, would you like to also tell them about the significance of morphological patterns of neovascular AMD? How do we use that also as a very useful tool to pick up like an early or end stage kind of a disease?
Yeah. So basically, I think all of you would have heard the terms Medusa head and dead tree. I think everybody will know that. So basically, what it means is the Medusa head is, as the name suggests, it's a tangled coil of vessels, a glomerulus of vessels indicating that there is activity. And once the eye is treated, when the activity reduces, you see the vessels become thinner, they become straighter, and there are less in number because the ends start shrinking. So that is what is called the branches of a dead tree. So that is something you need to identify. However, we know that even a fibrotic tissue can leak. So in addition to seeing these findings, you would also want to look at the corresponding B scan to check whether there is activity or not.
Yeah, Radhika, please.
Yes, word of caution, when you said the limitation, sometimes we pick up membranes that are not active in an asymptomatic patient. Now we don't have to go after them and treat them. It's just an indication that this patient does not need an annual visit. You want to see them
early. Right. So that actually answered the second question also that the audience has asked. Okay. So the next question is that which machines have wide field OCT angiography?
Currently, I use the Plex Elite, which is a machine from Zeiss. But there are other machines as well. I think the Avanti machine also has a wide field. And other machines, you can stitch together the pictures and get a montage. It's a little laborious, but you'll be able to get. The pictures I showed you are from the Plex Elite from Zeiss.
Right, ma'am. So these were the questions that were available online. So ma'am has answered the questions completely.
Ma'am, quickly, ma'am, how just how often now in your practice is OCT angio becoming a priority? In what conditions becoming a priority over fluorescein angiography? In which certain set conditions or diseases?
Yeah. Definitely for neovascular AMD and PCB, I am using because we know we don't have the facility for focal treatment. We no longer have TDT. And because TTT, we have used it in the past, it's a little unreliable. So most of us would be treating these patients with anti-VEGF agents. So I would use an OCT angiogram for most of these people for neovascular AMD. If I'm looking at a sick diabetic, then I will use an OCT angiogram even to evaluate for PDR. But definitely neovascular AMD, I very rarely ask for a fluorescein or an ICG. But if I'm looking at a patient with central serous retinopathy or a diabetic macular edema where I want to treat focally, then I would probably still ask for a fluorescein angiogram.
Another thing, ma'am, as a routine protocol, when you're doing OCT angiography, as you rightly pointed out, there is a 3x3 scan and there is a 6x6 scan. What we normally see is that when you use a smaller 3x3 scan, just wanted to add a comment, you tend to miss out on a lot of lesions when you're using it for vascular diseases. The patterns are missed out, the non-perfusions are missed out. So if you have a wider scan length, that really helps in vascular disease evaluations compared to the smaller scan length.
Yeah. The smaller scan you would look at for picking up for neovascular AMD. For diabetic retinopathy, we modify it even further. Even if I was to use my regular Zeiss angioplex, I will ask for an 8x8 montage. We can create a montage, but I would ask for it centered on the optic disc.
Okay.
That is something we tend to center all our scans on the macula.
Macula. Right.
But when I'm imaging a diabetic, I will always ask center on the disc because we know that a lot of neovascularization starts nasally and we tend to miss it. So for all my diabetics, my scans are centered on the optic disc.
Quite interesting, ma'am. Anything else, Rolika, coming up?
No. No, sir. Thanks a lot, ma'am, for covering the topic. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
I was just saying thank you, ma'am, for such an exhaustive topic and so simply put. I would also be going through this presentation at least a couple of more times to get everything that you have told to really. It was really a useful presentation, ma'am. Thank you so much.
You've probably seen parts of it so many times.
Yeah, but just to have it all together in one place is, I've seen diabetes separately and AMD separately, but I think getting all of it together, it was quite a useful presentation, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you
so much, ma'am. The next class that we have will be on December 15th. That will be by Dr. Shubhadra Jalari and Dr. Tapas Pari on basics of electrodiagnostics and clinical electrophysiology. We'll see you all there.
Thank you, Rolika. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir, for your time.
Thank you.